各位观众下午好，那么非常高兴在这一次的直播中和大家见面，我是本次直播的主持人兼翻译 Yuki。 那么说到波尔多的名酒呢，我相信很多人都听说过这样的一句话，就是左岸有拉菲，右岸有伯菲。那么今天我们非常荣幸地邀请到了伯菲酒庄的总经理啊，菲利普·德弗莱先生 Mr. Philip Devlay， 那来和我们聊一聊伯菲酒庄的故事啊。那么现在要提醒一下大家的是呢，在直播的过程中，如果大家有什么感兴趣的问题想提问我们的德弗莱先生的话，那么可以在下方直接评论。我们在直播最后一个环节呢，会挑选几个问题，那么来为大家解答。那么所以大家现在可以从直播的过程中也可以积极的提问。那么我们话不多说，现在就先让德弗莱先生来为我们简单的介绍一下伯菲酒庄，让大家来听一听他眼中的伯菲酒庄是什么样的呢？So, Mr. Devlay, would you please give us a brief introduction about Chateau Pavie?
Yes, Chateau Pavie is located in the best part of Saint-Emilion, on the limestone plateau. The elevation is 120 meters above the sea level, and that's the highest elevation in Saint-Emilion. Pavie has been bought by his current owner, Monsieur Perse, in 1998, and he has made a lot of work both in the vineyard and at the chateau. And we are now using the ultimate tools and the ultimate techniques to make a perfect wine.
那么这个伯菲酒庄呢，它是位于这个圣埃美隆的一个石灰岩的高地上，那么海拔大概是120米。那么伯菲酒庄的现在的拥有者呢是佩斯先生，那么1998年的时候呢，佩斯先生是购下了伯菲酒庄。那么在他接手了伯菲酒庄之后呢，他是对酒庄的一些酿酒技艺方面也是做了非常大的改进，那么对酒庄的发展呢是做出了非常大的贡献。 OK， 那么说完了伯菲酒庄呢，我相信大家对我身边的德弗莱先生呢也一定是相当的好奇。那么德弗莱先生呢，他是毕业于巴黎高等商学院，那么这一所学院呢是欧洲非常著名的商学院之一。那么德弗莱先生呢是在那里取得了工商管理硕士学位，那么这样的一位才子呢，是在去年的9月份正式加入伯菲酒庄任职总经理。那么我相信大家一定相当的好奇，伯菲德弗莱先生究竟为何是选择了伯菲酒庄呢？I have learned that you joined Pavie in September last year. So why do you choose Pavie?
Before joining Pavie, I used to work for Danone Group, and especially in the water division. I was managing the export of Evian and Volvic water brands. But I was passionate about wine, so about 10 years ago, I decided to move into the wine business.
是的，那么伯菲德弗莱先生说呢，他是之前是在达能集团，是作为依云矿泉水的全球总裁，是已经工作了20年的时间。那么因为他一直以来呢是对葡萄酒有着非常浓厚的兴趣，所以呢在10年前的时候，他决定进入葡萄酒这个行业。
I first moved to the Hess group. They have several vineyards around the world. I was managing these vineyards. Then I moved to a wine merchant in Bordeaux 8 years ago, and now to Chateau Pavie. Chateau Pavie is a wonderful wine, and my job is to make it known throughout the world, and especially in China.
那么2006年的时候呢，德弗莱先生是在一个名叫赫斯的集团，是负责其中的全球葡萄酒的贸易工作。那么紧接着呢，他是去到了波尔多，那么为一个拥有着120年历史的葡萄酒集团工作。 直到去年九月份的时候呢，他是去到了伯菲酒庄，那么任职总经理。那么在他眼里呢，伯菲酒庄是一个非常了不起的酒庄。那么他主要是负责其中的市场方面，尤其是在中国的市场方面。那么他希望能够让更多的葡萄酒爱好者认识和了解伯菲酒庄。那么 ，and so actually you are also quite experienced in the wine business. And so how do you feel about joining Pavie?
Joining Pavie is very exciting. We have the best among the best terroirs in Saint-Emilion.
Is the 那么问到呢？我是问到这个德弗莱先生呢，对于加入伯菲是有什么样的感受？那么他表示的是，他非常的兴奋，可以加入这样一座圣埃美隆非常顶级的一座酒庄。
The owner, Monsieur Pers, has invested a lot in the vineyard and at the chateau to make the best wine of Saint-Emilion.
那么。佩斯先生呢，他是在葡萄园和酒庄方面都做出了大量投资，那么为的就是能酿造出品质卓越的葡萄酒。
And I'm very excited to share this wine and to make it known from different customers in the world.
是，那么德弗莱先生呢，他是非常高兴能和世界的葡萄酒爱好者分享这些优质的葡萄酒。那么在刚刚德弗莱先生的介绍中，我们也了解到的是，伯菲酒庄呢是从2012年是由一级 B 等酒庄升级为这个一级 A 等酒庄。那么我相信大家一定和我一样的好奇，伯菲酒庄成功背后的秘诀究竟是什么呢？We all know that in the year 2012, Chateau Pavie was promoted to the rank.Of the premium Grand Cru Classe. So, in your eyes, what's the key of Pavie's success?
Monsieur Pers did very large investments with the objective of making the best wine, the best possible wine. So, an important thing is about the terroir.Pavie has a very unique terroir, this limestone plateau in Saint-Emilion, which is the best part of Saint-Emilion. But Pavie, some of it is also located on a slope, on a clay slope. And this allowed a combination between the two kinds of terroir with the two grapes.We have Merlot on the plateau, and we have Cabernet on the slope. And this unique combination makes Pavie a fantastic wine.
那么在佩斯先生是接手了伯菲酒庄之后呢，他是对酒庄做出了大量的投资。那么德弗莱先生认为呢，伯菲酒庄是拥有着整个圣埃美隆产区非常好的风土。那么其中有一部分呢是葡萄园是位于这个石灰岩高地之上，那么这个土壤呢是非常适合梅洛这个葡萄品种的种植，那么还有另一部分呢是位于这个斜坡之上，那么上面的这个土壤主要是粘土，那么非常适合这另一个葡萄品种品丽珠的种植。
Pavie was awarded with 400 points Parker for vintage 2000, 2005, 2009, and 2010.
那么德弗莱先生也说到呢，这个伯菲酒庄呢是其中是有四个年份的酒呢是获得了知名的酒评家罗伯特帕克这个满分的好评，那么这四个年份分别是2000年、2005年、2009年以及2010年。
And 2012, it was awarded first growth classified A, joining Cheval Blanc and Chateau Ozone in this very limited group in the elite of Saint-Emilion.
那么伯菲2012年的这个年份的葡萄酒呢也是表现非常的不错，那么是几乎是和这个白马酒庄所酿造的葡萄酒是同一个水平。 And 那么我们刚刚也提到了，就是呢和伯菲的齐名的还有就是山美龙分级制度中呢，在一阶等酒庄中，除了伯菲氏，还有白马、欧颂，还有金钟酒庄。那么在德弗莱先生的眼中呢，伯菲与这其他三个一阶等酒庄有什么样的独特之处呢 ？And so compared to the other three premium Grand Cru Class A, what do you think are the distinctive features of Pavie?
Every wine.Is different. The uniqueness of Pavie is due to the combination of the two terroirs. The Merlot grows and gives its best expression on the limestone plateau. And the Cabernet, mostly Cabernet Franc, gives its best expression on clay on the slopes.And Pavie has a very unique combination of these two terroirs.
那么德弗莱先生呢是说到这个伯菲的葡萄酒是非常的独一无二的。那么这种独特性呢是跟它的风土有非常大的关系。那么在上一个问题当中呢，德弗莱先生也是提到了。酒庄的这个梅洛呢是种植在这个石灰岩高地上的。那么梅洛这个品种的特性是在这种土壤中得到了非常好的诠释，那么同时还有另一部分，也就是斜坡上面的粘土上是种植的是品丽珠这个葡萄，那么这两个葡萄品种呢都是在它的风土上是表现非常的不错。
The limestone plateau has the highest elevation in Saint-Emilion with 120 metersand it's all facing the south, which means with this elevation we have coolness, we have wind, and we have a very good sun exposure to make the grapes ripe better.
Yes. 那么由于酒庄这个是位于圣埃美隆最高的山坡上，这个海拔呢是达到了120米，而且呢葡萄园是面朝南方，那么也就因为这一点呢是葡萄园可以获得了充足的光照，而且呢是还有气候非常的凉爽，那么这也适合葡萄的种植。And I know that Cabernet Sauvignon is also used in as one of the blending variety. So what kind of role do you think Cabernet Sauvignon play in the wine?
The existing blend of Chateau Pavie is 60% Merlot, 35% Cabernet Franc, 25% Cabernet Franc and 15% Cabernet Sauvignon. So all together there is a 40% Cabernet. Merlot gives a lot of fruit, a lot of roundness, a lot of softness in Pavie. The Cabernet, Cabernet Franc and Cabernet Sauvignon gives structure and elegance.And the combination of both makes the wine very unique.
那么是赤霞珠。我刚刚是问到这个德弗莱先生是那个赤霞珠在这个葡萄酒中是扮演了一个怎么样的角色？那么他的回答是呢，赤霞其中梅洛的品种呢是主要占了60%。品丽珠的这个比例是25%，那么赤霞珠是15%，也就是说呢，品丽珠和赤霞珠加起来是占了40%。那么其中梅洛在葡萄酒中，它主要是提供了这个果香以及 圆润的口感。那么赤霞珠和品丽珠呢，是这个提供了结构，以及使得酿造出来的葡萄酒有这种优雅的风格。
When Mr. Peirce has bought Chateau Pavie in 1998, the grapes were 70% Merlot. But we are targeting in the near future to have 50% Merlot and to increase the part of Cabernet Franc. Because all the vineyard is facing south, we can have a very ripe Cabernet Franc. And they had fruit and structure and elegance to Chateau Pavie.
那么德弗莱先生呢，刚刚是说到佩斯先生呢是在1998年买下伯菲酒庄的时候，那么当时呢，他的比例其实梅洛的比例其实是有70%，但是呢，德弗莱先生说呢，在未来可能他们可能会把这个梅洛的品种，降低到比例降低到50%，那么品丽珠的它的比例可能会略有提高。那么这是因为呢，这个葡萄园它是面朝南方，那么这个品丽珠这一个品种它是可以达到一个比较适合的成熟度。那么这样一来呢，就可以给葡萄酒提供充足的果香，还有一个结构感，还有一种优雅的风格。那么近两年呢，如果有朋友是去参观过我们的伯菲酒庄的话，那么应该会发现酒庄现在的面貌已经是焕然一新。那么这是因为呢，从2011年开始，酒庄就经历了一个长达2年多之久的翻新工程。那么这一次翻新工程呢，酒庄是邀请了著名的建筑设计师阿尔伯特品托先生设计了一个新的酒窖。那么不知道这一次的翻新工程又给酒庄带来了哪些变化呢？我们还是来听一听德弗莱先生怎么说。And I know that starting from the year 2011, Chateau Pavie has experienced a refurbishment project. So what difference do you think such a project has brought to Pavie?
The owner, Mr. First, is obsessed by quality and innovation.So he is constantly looking for the ultimate techniques and knowledges to make Chateau Pavie become better. So reached to a certain point, we decided in 2011 to make a big refurbishment of Chateau Pavie, which allowed to be up to date and with the ultimate techniques to do the best wine.Ever, maybe in Pavie.
Okay, 那么佩斯先德弗莱先生是说到啊，佩斯先生呢，是非常的重视这个葡萄酒的质量，还有这个技术的创新上面。所以呢，在接手了这个伯菲酒庄之后，他是在这方面下了非常大的功夫。那么是决定在2011年的时候对酒庄进行一个翻修。那么为的也是提高了这个葡萄酒的质量，是更新了一些酿酒设备。
And this constant search for innovation, for getting the best wine, has been rewarded by the classification A in 2012.
那么这样的创新呢，也是得到了一定的成果，也就是呢，2012年的时候，伯菲酒庄呢是从一级 B 等酒庄升级为一级 A 等酒庄。那么可见呢，这些设备的更新上面还是给酒庄葡萄酒的质量带来了一定的提高。那么说完了伯菲酒庄呢，我觉得我们接下来应该是要来聊一聊伯菲的酒了。那么我觉得这也是广大的观众朋友们非常感兴趣的一个部分。那么如果观众朋友们对伯菲的酒还不是特别熟悉的话也没有关系，那么我们接下来先让德弗莱先生来用几个词简单的形容一下伯菲葡萄酒是怎么样的一种风格。And Mr. Devlay, if you are asked to use a few words to describeBavie's wine, what words will you use?
Elegance, fruit, and power.
那么 德弗莱先生呢是用了这个三个词，那么第一个呢是优雅，第二个呢是这个充足的果香，那么第三个呢则是这种力量感。 And so what factors do you think that help to create such a style of wine? is it the terroir, the proportion of grape variety, so the winemaking techniques, or the combination of all these factors?
That's a unique combination of all these factors, obviously. as I explained earlier, the Merlot gives its best expression on the limestone plateau. And the limestone plateau is the best limestone in Saint-Emilion, thanks to the elevation, thanks to the wind, thanks to the sun. And it's combined with a perfect expression also for Cabernet on the slope, with claystone and with the sun exposure. So this combination of natural gifts of the terroir plus the constant look for innovation and for having the best quality possible makes this Pavie wine just amazing.
那么呢问到了这个酒庄的葡萄酒究竟是怎么样创造出这么一种风格的葡萄酒，也就是刚刚说到的优雅、果香浓郁还有这种力量感。那么德弗莱先生呢是说到这与风土是离不开的。那么在前面我们也说到了这个石灰岩高地上的梅洛，以及这个斜坡上的品丽珠和赤霞珠。那么德弗莱先生呢认为这都是大自然的馈赠。那么风土呢是在伯菲葡萄酒这个风格上面是做出了非常大的贡献。那么相信呢听完了观众朋友们对伯菲的酒应该是已经有了一个大概的认识。那么大多数的酒友都知道，在不一样的年份里呢受当年气候条件的影响，酒庄的葡萄酒呢它的表现也会有所不同，而且呢每一款酒是都会有它的也会有它的适应期。那么我相信这个酒迷们一定非常想知道酒庄是有哪一些年份的酒是特别值得推荐呢，而且呢又有哪一些是已经到达了它的适应期呢？ And so we all know that wines from different vintages may taste differently because the climate condition varies from year to year.
Yes.
And so, as the general manager of Pavie, would you please recommend several vintages for our wine lovers? And which vintages do you think are ready to drink now?
Okay. At Pavie, we are only looking for quality, not quantity. If we have a regular vintage, we just pick the best grapes to make the best possible wine. If we have a very good year, we pick more grapes and we make more wine. But both wines are very good. Now we have some wines, some vintages like 2007 or 2013, which are ready to drink. But we have also other vintages like 2010, 2012, which can be drunk now if you decant the bottles 1 or 2 hours before.
1 or 2 hours?
Yes.
Okay. 那么这个德弗莱先生呢是说到伯菲酒庄呢他最重视的是葡萄酒的质量而不是葡萄酒的产量。那么在最好的年份里呢伯菲酒庄会挑选这质量最好的葡萄。那么比较好的年份呢德弗莱先生说到是这个2007年和2013年是特别值得推荐的。那么当然2010年和2012年呢现在也是可以开瓶，但是德弗莱先生的建议就是说呢这两个年份的酒呢在喝之前最好是醒酒1到2个小时。那么 And I have another question, is that what makes such a great aging potential? Because I know Pavie's wine has quite a great aging potential. And what factors do you think that contributes to
the aging of Pavie?
Yes, aging potential.
Okay. What makes aging potential is due to the structure of the wine, the tannins and the acidity of the wine. If you take the grapes too ripe, the wine might be very strong, very good, very fruity, but it will not last long. But if you take the grapes not ripe enough, the wine doesn't taste good. So there is this unique and important combination in the way you choose the right time for picking up, for harvesting the grapes. And we have the know-how to choose the best time so that there is a good combination between ripeness and pleasure to drink the wine now and aging potential. Mr. Perse, the owner, wants the wine to be drunk and to be still very good after 10, 20 or 30 years. So he is the one who decides when to pick up the grapes and how to blend it to make sure that the wine has aging potential.
Okay, so it has much to do with the tannin and the acidity level.
Yes.
OK, 那么问到这个德弗莱先生呢，这个伯菲酒庄的葡萄酒究竟是为什么有这么好的陈年潜力呢？那么德弗莱先生是说到这与其中的单宁和酸度有非常好的有非常大的关系。那么如果是佩斯先生呢，伯菲酒庄的庄主佩斯先生呢，是非常重视这个葡萄酒的陈年潜力。那么伯菲的葡萄酒，它是可以陈年20甚至30年的时间。那么佩斯先生呢，他是会决定这个葡萄的采收期。那么在葡萄达到一个非常完美的成熟度的时候，将其采摘下来，那么以保证它这个单宁和酸度之间的一个平衡。那么酿造出来的葡萄酒呢，口感不仅好，还会对它的陈年潜力也有非常大的影响。那么我们都知道，好酒不仅可以用来喝，还可以用来投资。那么2015年的七酒市场也是相当的火热。那么其中伯菲酒庄2015年的七酒呢，是获得了这个知名的酒评家詹姆士萨克林，也就是我们熟知的 JS 的满分好评。那么作为伯菲的总经理，不知道德弗莱先生他又对这款酒有着怎么样的评价，那么认为他的市场潜力又是怎么样的呢？So I know that the 2015 I know the 2015 Pavie in Primer was well received by many wine critics,
mm-hmm.
and among which James Suckling even
yes.
gave it a full mark. So how will you comment on this wine, and what about its market potential?
Okay, 2015 is an exceptional vintage. As I told before, Pavie has been already rewarded by 400 points in 2000, 2005, 9, and 10. We believe 2015 is even higher in quality because the vineyard is more aged now, and on top of that, we have more and more experience and understanding and knowledge of the vineyard and of the techniques. So the combination of both makes for this 2015 vintage a fantastic vintage. Yes, maybe better than all the previous ones.
OK, 那么是刚刚德弗莱先生呢也是说到了这个在收到这个詹姆士萨克林2015年份这个满分之前呢，这个伯菲酒庄其实是已经收到了是罗伯特帕克四个 四个满分那么这些年份分别是00年、05年、09年以及10年。那么他认为呢，这个2015年呢是质量更高的一个年份。那么这是和德弗莱先生说呢，这是和这个葡萄树的年龄有一定的关系。那么其次呢，就是酒庄在酿酒方面经验更加的丰富，然后呢，这也和这个酒庄的这个酿酒技艺的提升方面也是离不开的。那么听完了德弗莱先生的回答呢，我相信已经购买了伯菲2015年七九的朋友们也是可以尽情的期待一下。那么在我不知道大家有没有关注过这个伯菲酒庄的相关新闻。那么在2013年呢，酒庄的女庄主佩斯女士呢，在接受采访的时候是曾经表示过，中国呢是这个伯菲最重要的市场之一。那么针对中国的市场呢，不知道酒庄又有没有什么针对性的这个宣传推广举措？那么我们现在来听一听德弗莱先生怎么说。And I have learned that during Mrs. Peirce, she claimed that China was one of the most important markets, and in an interview in 2013.
Mm-hmm.
So, what has Pavie done to try to promote the wines in the Chinese market?
Okay. Chinese market is very important for Chateau Pavie. We have a very limited production, as we take only the best grapes to do a limited amount of wine. And there is in China more and more consumers who recognize the quality of this wine. So what we are doing to promote Pavie in China is first to host and to welcome the Chinese Pavie customers in Saint-Emilion at the Chateau. Mr. Peirce and Mrs. Peirce, the owners, also have the best hotel and restaurant in Saint-Emilion. So if Chinese visitors want to come and visit us, they can visit the Chateau, taste the wine, and stay at the hotel and restaurant. But I will also travel a lot to China, two, three, maybe more, four times a year, to make wine dinners and to meet with the customers to give explanations and answer their questions about Chateau Pavie.
Okay, so is this your first time to be present in such a live stream?
That's the first time for Chateau Pavie, yes.
First time?
Yes.
Okay. And how do you feel about it?
I love it.
Okay. 那么问到这个伯菲酒庄呢，是对中国市场有什么这个针对性的宣传推广举措？那么德弗莱先生呢是说到，中国确实是伯菲酒庄一个非常重要的市场。那么酒庄呢是通过这个有限的葡萄酒产量来保证这个葡萄酒的质量。那么在中国呢，是有越来越多的消费者是了解这个波尔多名庄的酒，那么他们也是越来越重视这个葡萄酒的质量。那么德弗莱先生说到，如果大家呢是对伯菲的酒感兴趣的话，是可以去到这个伯菲酒庄品尝他们的美酒。那么庄主这个佩斯夫妇呢，也是非常欢迎大家去到酒庄品鉴。那么德弗莱先生呢，他的本身呢也是会每年都会来几次中国两到三次甚至是四次，来和这个我们的消费者见面，并且向他们展示这个酒庄的葡萄酒。So another question is there any change in winemaking during the recent years? Winemaking techniques?
Yes, there are always small improvements to make the wine better. Very little things, but we are always... Mr. Peirce is reinvesting every year what he earns to improve the quality of the vineyard, to improve the quality of the wine in the cellar. So yes, we are, and he is, always looking to do the best and to improve the quality of Pavie. But some of the things are secret, so I will keep them for me.
Okay. 那么刚刚是问到呢，这个酒庄在近年来这个酿酒技艺上有没有哪一些方面的改变呢？那么德弗莱先生是提到了说，这个酒庄呢是每一年呢都在提升他们葡萄酒的质量。那么佩斯先生呢在这一方面是做了很多的投资，比如说哎这个酒窖里面的这个设备的这种更新，那么是非常非常有助于提升这个伯菲酒庄葡萄酒的质量。那么我们都知道，如果遇到一些不好的年份的话呢，这个年份它对葡萄酒的质量是会有非常大的影响。那么就特别想知道，如果遇到不好的年份，酒庄又会怎么样保持它的这种葡萄酒的风格呢？那么我们还是来听一听德弗莱先生会怎么样为我们解答。And so if caught in a bad vintage, how does Pavie try to maintain the style of the wine?
Sorry?
If caught in a bad vintage, and how will Chateau Pavie try to maintain the style of the wine? The quality of the wine?
Yeah. The quality of the wine is constant throughout the vintages. Mr. Perse does Pavie wine. His first vintage is 1998.And you can open every bottle since 1998, and every bottle is at the highest quality. One vintage is different to another due to the weather condition, to the climate of the vintage. But every wine ages well because, as I explained earlier, thanks to the tannins and acidity, he decided to make the wine such that it can age a lot. So every bottle you drink of Pavie is different, but every bottle ages well.
那么德弗莱先生呢的回答他是这样的，他是表示了这个伯菲酒庄它的葡萄酒呢，它的质量呢是相对的稳定的。那么从这个佩斯先生98年接手了酒庄之后呢，98年之后，酒庄生产的葡萄酒质量都是相对的优质。那么即使是在有一些这个气候不好的年份里呢，这些年份里生产的葡萄酒呢，它的这个陈年潜力还是相对的比较好，因为葡萄酒呢有它，葡萄酒中是有这个单宁和酸度来作为支撑。And 那么我相信大家如果有关注伯菲酒庄的话，可能会了解伯菲酒庄呢曾经是引起了一些酒评家的争议。那么人们常说伯菲的葡萄酒呢既有这个法国葡萄酒骨子里的优雅与平衡，那么又有新世界酒的个性与力量。那么不知道德弗莱先生会怎么样去评价这一句话呢？ AndIt is said that Pavie's wine combine both French wine's elegance and balance, and also the New World wine's power and personality.
Mm-hmm.
And so, how do you comment on this sentence?
That's a result of a terroir, and it has been always through the time.The characteristics of Pavie. The freshness and elegance is due to the limestone soil, and the roots of the vines are crossing 15 meters or 20 meters of limestone, which gives structure and elegance and a little bit salty final.Taste to the wine. But the sun is here and the Cabernet on the slope to give ripeness, to give fruit, to give power. And this unique terroir of Chateau Pavie is a unique combination which makes it very distinctive and very different from all other wines in Saint-Emilion and in the world.
是的，那么说到呢，对刚刚这一句话的评价呢，这个德弗莱先生是说到，这个伯菲酒庄呢有这样一种风格呢，还是和它的风土有着非常大的关系。那么，也是在刚刚也是我们已经说到了，在石灰岩的这个高地上，梅洛是在这一片风土上是得到了非常好的诠释。那么赤霞珠和品丽珠呢，则是为这个伯菲的葡萄酒提供了非常好的这个结构。那么伯菲酒庄的葡萄酒呢，正是这三种葡萄品种这个个性的结合，所以呢跟这个葡萄品种的特性也是离不开。还有非常重要的一点就是它的风土。
Mr. Pess has also other vineyards.And one of them is called Pavie de Cesse. Pavie de Cesse is 90% Merlot, as opposed to 60% for Pavie, and is 100% on the limestone plateau. It makes it different from Pavie, but this wine is also exceptional. And I personally like very much the 2008 vintage of Pavie de Cesse.
2008
Pavie de Cesse. A lot of structure, a lot of elegance.
Okay. 那么德弗莱先生是说到呢，这个佩斯先生他的名下是还有一个酒庄，是叫做这个伯菲德凯斯酒庄。那么这个酒庄呢，它的这个葡萄品种的种植比例呢，是和这个伯菲酒庄是有一定的不同。那么其中呢，梅洛的比例是占到了90%。那么德弗莱先生也是表示，他个人呢是非常喜欢这个伯菲德凯斯酒庄的这个葡萄酒。那么因为呢，这个葡萄酒是有着一个富有结构感，并且有着一个优雅的风格。And we all know that the 2016 Bordeaux in Primer tasting is coming. So, what do you think are the main characteristics of the 2016 vintage?
2016 is a very good vintage too. I would say it's an outstanding vintage. At the Chateau, we are now working and tasting every single vat.And trying to figure out what the blending of it could be. That's a fantastic vintage. We had perfect weather condition. The summer was very dry, but the limestone retains the water so that our vineyard did never suffer from the drought. So we have very late harvest, around the 20th of October. So the ripe, the grapes could ripe in perfect condition until very late in October.
那么说到这个2016年份呢，德弗莱先生是说到这一年份也是算得上是非常好的一个年份。那么酒庄的这个团队呢，也是不断的在从每一个这个酒桶中品尝，那么尝试去了解这些混酿的比例，怎么样才能够做到最好。那么2016年呢，这个德弗莱先生也说到了，这个天气状况还是非常的完美。那么呢，在这个酒庄葡萄园这个土壤深层呢，是有一个这个地下湖。那么这个湖呢，也就是提供了这样充足的水分。那么就算是在非常干旱的条件下呢，这个酒庄的葡萄呢，也不会受到太大的影响。那么酒庄的2016年份呢，酒庄的葡萄呢，也是在达到一个非常好的成熟度的情况下，才被采摘下来。那么相信这个2016年份的伯菲葡萄酒应该是也有着不错的表现。And 那么我们都知道这个酒庄呢是有它的这个正牌酒和它的副牌酒，那么我相信很多酒友们心中可能会有这样的一个疑问，就是这个正牌酒它的和这个副牌酒主要的差别是在哪里呢？那么我们现在听一听德弗莱先生会怎么说。 And another question is what do you think are the main differences of the first label and the second wines of Chateau Pavie?
We have a second label which is called Arôme de Pavie. Arôme de Pavie is made out of the youngest vines of the terroir of the vineyard. We consider that to join the Pavie blending, the vine should be at least 10 years old. But between 5 and 10 years or 12 years, these vines go into the second label, the second wine, Arôme de Pavie.
那么说到这个博菲的副牌酒啊，博菲的副牌酒它的名字是这个博菲香气。那么这个副牌酒呢，它是采用这个比较年轻的这个葡萄来这个酿造。那么葡萄树的树龄呢，大概是十年左右。那么所以呢，博菲的副牌酒呢，就是采用这个相对年轻的这个葡萄来酿造。
The same people are taking care.The same techniques are used for both the first and the second label.
So there are no differences on winemaking techniques?
No.
Okay. 那么这个呢，博菲的副牌酒它的酿造技艺呢，其实是和它的正牌酒没有任何的差别。And then what about the proportion of the grape varieties?
It's about the same depending on the years. We probably have a little bit more Merlot in the Arôme de Pavie, but it depends very much on the year.
Okay, second label, more Merlot.
Yes.
那么是问到呢，这个副牌酒它的酿造这个品种比例和正牌酒有什么不同呢？博菲先生呢是说到这是取决于当年份的情况。那么一般来说呢，这个副牌酒里面梅洛所占到的品种是会比较多。And so personally, how do you comment on the second wine of Chateau Pavie?
The second wine.Has got the same characteristics, the same personality as Chateau Pavie. Fruit, elegance, with some power. But as the vineyard, as the vines, as the grapes are younger, it makes a much more ready-to-drink wine. I would say that Chateau Pavie is really for amateurs, for connoisseurs,For people who have a strong wine background, when Arôme de Pavie can be drunk more easily by everybody, and everybody will love it.
So it's more.
And understand it.
Okay, it's more easy to drink.
It's more easy to drink, it's more accessible to everybody's consumption. Yeah.
Okay. 那么说到这个副牌酒呢，德弗莱先生，个人认为呢，这个。副牌酒呢也是具有充足的果香，那么是有一种比较优雅的风格，那么同时还具有这种力量感。那么他认为呢，博菲的副牌酒呢是相对的易饮，那么他认为是适合各种人群都可以饮用的这么一款酒。And so 那么直播到现在呢。我相信这个很多朋友们都是对博菲酒庄啊以及它的酒已经有了一定的认识。那么接下来呢，就是我们的这个观众的提问环节。那么我们接下来会从这个观众的评论中是挑选几个问题，来看一看大家对这个博菲酒庄呢有什么样的问题是比较感兴趣的。那么我们就来问一问德弗莱先生。那么我看到的一个 首先第一个问题是我们有观众朋友是比较好奇这个去伯菲酒庄喝酒是需要支付多少费用，那么我相信这也是很多的朋友们比较关心的一个问题。 So how much does it cost to taste Pavie's wine? To go to Chateau Pavie to taste your wine?
Okay. We have so much demand and so much people want to visit Chateau Pavie that we want to keep for every visitor the best quality. We want every visitor to have a peaceful moment so that he can enjoy Chateau Pavie as if he were, and actually he is alone visiting Pavie. So we have to make paid entries, and the cost is 35 euros to visit Chateau Pavie per person. This includes a 1 hour visit at the chateau, a full visit of the chateau, plus the tasting of two wines, one Chateau Pavie and one other wine of, made by Monsieur Perse.
Okay. 那么这个德弗莱先生是说到这个伯菲酒庄呢，是这个广大酒友们如果有机会去到伯菲酒庄的话呢，他们是这个酒庄的费用是这样的，是35欧元每人。那么呢，这个费用呢是包括了这个酒庄的参观啊，还有这个两杯葡萄酒的品鉴。And so, I know that many people nowadays they like to, they are quite interested in wine tours, and maybe they go abroad to visit those chateaus. So, what do you think are the most attractive aspects of Chateau Pavie's wine tourism?
Chateau Pavie will show them a unique location, so they will. I think they have to come to the chateau and then have a short walk or drive through the vineyard to, there is a fantastic view on the Saint-Emilion village from Chateau Pavie. They can take very nice pictures. So Chateau Pavie, if they visit Chateau Pavie, they will understand the best of the terroir of Saint-Emilion and have a beautiful and unique sense and unique feeling of Chateau Pavie and Saint-Emilion.
是的，那么近年来呢，也是有非常多的葡萄酒爱好者呢，是去到国外的酒庄这个参观品鉴葡萄酒。那么问到呢，这个伯菲酒庄呢，在葡萄酒旅游业方面有什么特别吸引人的地方呢？那么德弗莱先生是这样说到，就是去到伯菲酒庄的时候呢，我们的酒友们呢是可以一览这个葡萄园的这个美丽景色。那么其次呢，这个酒庄在经过翻新之后呢，这酒窖啊也是对这个品鉴室和接待室是做出了翻新，那么相信能够给这个很多酒友们一种非常愉悦的感受。 And okay, let's see if there are any other questions from the audience. Yes. And one of our audience asked, can you tell something about the price of the 2016 vintage of Pavie? And compared to the vintage 2015, will the price be higher or lower?
We don't know the price yet. We need first to make the blending and to make sure the wines meet our expectations. So we have our own conviction. We are sure that 2016 today will be even better than 2015. So I don't know the price, but I know for sure that the price will not be lower than 2015.
Will not be lower?
Not lower.
Okay. 那么说到这个，有观众朋友们是问到了这个2016年这个伯菲酒庄的酒呢，它的价格，相对于2015年来说，这个价格呢是会，高还是低呢？那么德弗莱先生是说到，他们现在呢也不确定这个16年份的葡萄酒的价格是怎样， 但他们呢是但他们是期望这个2016年的葡萄酒能够达到酒庄自己的期望。那么他们相信呢2016年份的葡萄酒呢是会比2015年份的酒是更好。那么他也说到这个价格呢是应该是不会低于15年葡萄酒的价格。And那么还有观众朋友们是问到了这个2011年份的伯菲酒庄的葡萄酒，那么它是这样问的，2011年份的伯菲酒庄红葡萄酒在这个酿酒工艺上是否有什么特别之处，还有呢是什么样的因素造就了这一款酒。 And so one of our audience asked about the 2011 vintage Chateau Pavie, mm-hmm. and he asked about is there anything special on winemaking techniques in making the 2011 Chateau Pavie?
There has been nothing specific in 2011. 2011 is a cooler vintage than usual. So the wine has good acidity, has good tannins, and as it is not as ripe as other vintages, it can be drunk now. So if you have Pavie 2011, I recommend it can age another 5, 10, or even 20 years. But it's the kind of vintage that you can drink in the coming months or coming years. Just open the bottle, decant it 1 or 2 years before, and you will have a wonderful experience.
Okay, 那么说到这个2011年份的这个伯菲酒庄的葡萄酒，德弗莱先生的回答是这样的。那么2011年份呢是一个相对气候比较凉爽的年份。那么葡萄酒呢是这个具有一定的酸度和单宁。那么德弗莱先生他是说到这个2011年份葡萄酒是具有一定的陈年潜力，那么它可以陈年5年、10年甚至20年之久。那么如果是有观众朋友们是购买了这个2011年份的葡萄酒的话，是可以开瓶的时候是可以提前醒酒1到2个小时，那么口感就会更佳一点。Maybe we have time for another question.
Okay. 谢谢。
那么有观众朋友是对这个伯菲的七酒比较感兴趣，那么他是问到每年伯菲的七酒放出来的这个配额是有多少箱？那么我们现在来听一听德弗莱先生的回答。And another audience asked about the Pavie in primer, and he asked about how many cases of allocation Pavie will give to the market every year.
Okay. The production of Chateau Pavie is around 80,000 bottles. Every year we keep a certain amount at the chateau to be released for the future. Depending on the years, we keep at the chateau between 50% and 70% of the production. So which makes that in an average year, about 50,000 bottles only are released in the market. This is not enough for the whole world. We have big markets in the United States, in UK, in Hong Kong, and Asia is growing, and China is growing a lot. So that's the interest of buying en primeur. If you buy en primeur, you are sure to get your allocation of the vintage, of a great vintage like 2015 or 16. If you wait, you are not sure to find the wine year after.
So 50,000 bottles released to the market?
Yes.
是，那么这个德弗莱先生呢是说到这个酒庄的年产量呢大约是这个8万瓶。 那么说到这个投放到这个市场中的这个葡萄酒的数量呢，是这个50,000瓶左右。那么今天的直播呢到这里也是接近了尾声。那么在这里也是要提醒一下大家呢，就是为了回馈广大酒友们一直以来对这个红酒世界的支持，那么即日起至2月26号呢，凡购买这个2011年份的伯菲酒庄红葡萄酒，那么酒友们可以享受以下的优惠，就是可以享受这个 VIP 尊享价，也就是95折。那么这个还有一个优惠呢，就是如果整箱6瓶购买的话呢，是可以加配这个原装木箱。好，那么今天的直播到这里就结束了，谢谢大家。So thank you, Mr. Devlay, for today's live stream, and we look forward to your next visit.
Thank you very much, and enjoy Pavie. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Maybe we go this way.